Good morning, everyone.
Well, first of all, I would like to congratulate the organization of these conferences, my dear friend Teresa Violente and the municipality of Cascais, for choosing the topic this year, which is, of course, the major concern in Europe and in other places of the world. The migration flows, the displacement of people is a topic of utmost importance in a globalized world where human rights are at stake every day. The topic of this panel seems to me a very important one because it addresses the displacement factors, the causes of the displacement of people in the world. And as Clara Tsoz already mentioned, there's a large number of people displaced, both refugees, so international displacement, and also internally displaced people, which sometimes are forgotten in these movements, but are, of course, very important because we have large numbers of people that are displaced from their homes within the same country. And that's, of course, also a factor of concern. So, for many years, and the convention, the 1951 Convention on the Protection of Refugees, which was designed, drafted shortly after the Second World War and thought for the Second World War, but for many years, the refugee situation was directly connected with war and conflict. So the way the convention was designed was pretty much around the idea of war and conflict. But the fact is that today we are seeing an increasing movement of displacements that are due to different causes. So a first thing that we need to acknowledge is that the displacement of people today is not only connected to war and conflict, but also to other factors such as global warming, which is producing difficulty in the farming of areas in the world. So access to food and water is becoming more and more difficult in some places of the world. Some places are not even livable, not only because of access to food, but also because of the high rise of the water levels. And all these derives into a concept that has been under discussion recently, which is the idea of food security. And the idea of food security is basically to provide food and water for people for the next decade. So how does the world assure that the world population will have access to food and water in the future? And that's, of course, a matter of security. That's why the concept includes the idea of security connected to food, because food insecurity, for that matter, implies the displacement of people, the pressure on the borders, and all sorts of conflicts that may arise from food insecurity because mass movements of people will need to search for food and water. Also, if we look at the situation in the Mediterranean currently, one might think from what we hear, that the situation in the Mediterranean is mainly caused by the conflict in Syria. And this is not true. If we look at the worst year in terms of pressure, which was 2015, where more than 1 million people entered Europe, in 2015, only roughly 55% of the migrants arriving in Europe were from Syria. So there was a large group of people that were not originated in Syria. And if we look right now, probably because of the agreement between the European Union and Turkey, the Syrians are in the fifth or sixth place of entries in Europe right now. So the nationalities that are more represented in 2017 in terms of entry in the Mediterranean are Nigeria, Bangladesh, Guinea, Cote d'Ivoire, and Gambia. Only after that comes Syria. So we are watching more and more arrivals from countries of sub-Saharan Africa. And in some sub-Saharan Africa, of course, there's conflict. There are conflicts and wars, but also matters of food security. So what we are seeing is that conflicts, traditional conflicts, are no longer the major reason for people to be displaced. And of course, from a legal point of view, we need to address what has been already mentioned this morning. We need to address the need to revise the convention, because again, the convention was drafted in 1951. It was drafted after the Second World War. It was designed for a world where the major factor of displacement were wars and conflicts. And as I said today, there are many other factors. And the truth of the matter is that someone that is migrating to escape from a situation where the land where that person or family are living is no longer livable, or there's no access to food and water, that person, that family, will not be considered under the convention as a refugee, because that person, that family, does not qualify as a refugee, because as Clara Sousa also mentioned, to be considered legally under the convention as a refugee, it has to prove that there's a well-founded fear of being persecuted for reasons of race, religion, nationality, belonging to a social group, or political opinion. So majorly, we are talking about political refugees, not environmental refugees, not refugees that are looking for food and water, for escaping for food insecurity. Of course, there are some countries in the world that are enlarging the concept, but that's mainly a national decision. So we need to revise the convention so there's an international consensus about that. Of course, there are risks associated with the idea of revising the convention. We are now in a very important moment because the New York Declaration announced the intention of a large number of heads of state and government to engage in a world discussion, in a global discussion about migration and refugee regulation. It's not clear yet whether that will imply a revision of the convention, so the negotiation is still starting right now. There's a roadmap that was put forward by the co-conveners, which are the ambassadors to Mexico and Switzerland. So we are now starting this discussion. But certainly one possibility is also to look at the convention, at the refugee convention, and think about that. Of course, there are risks. And I will quote the current UN Secretary General that was previously the UN High Commissioner for Refugees and happens to be a Portuguese, our fellow António Guterres, and he pointed a very interesting risk. He said, while he was the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, he said that revising the convention in a world like the one we are living today will probably end in a result that is worse in terms of human rights protection than the convention that we have today. And that's actually very appalling, because how can we have a convention in the 21st century that is even worse than the one that was designed after the Second World War? But he's probably right. He knows what he's talking about, so he's probably right. But nevertheless, there's this risk, of course. We are facing a very dangerous world, not only in terms of the situation of the human rights protection, but also in terms of the public opinion perceptions and the political leadership in terms of human rights protection. But I do think that despite these risks, the world is changing so much. The need for human rights protection and the causes of displacement are so diverse these days that there's a substantial need for revising the convention, not only from an economic migrant's perspective, creating legal routes for migration, which is probably the primary concern of the New York Declaration, but also in terms of the concept of refugee, enlarging it to embrace these new realities, which are actually the ones who are producing the new refugees and will originate future flows and migration pressure in the world borders. Thank you very much.